Greetings, Benjamin J. the Victual Guy, with another in the series. Well, I finally got a gem. I've been playing with this for about the last, oh, I don't know, 5-6 hours. It got here about 1 o'clock. It's now, wow, 9:30, so I've been playing with it for a while. And it's really funny, you know, I've been looking for a gem to use as a portable recorder, just for doing voice recording. Taking it around, showing it to people, showing what an Edison cylinder machine can do. And it's really funny, I found this on eBay as a parts machine. And as far as a gem goes, it was actually fairly inexpensive, $271. Came with the original lid, original case, and the lid's in fair condition. It's got some issues. It needs to be glued here and there, and it definitely needs to be cleaned and have some wood feeder put on it, but it's really not in that bad a condition. It's got one crack there that can be repaired and will be almost invisible. So the cabinet itself isn't bad, not great, but isn't bad. The machine itself, when it got here, was just absolutely totally inoperable. I always wonder. First thing I do is I check the bearings for the mandrel, the intermediate gear, and the feed screw. All of them were so tight I absolutely couldn't move. I mean, the mandrel, you could move it. It was obvious it was never going to run. I mean, you could put a chain drive on it, and it would not run, let alone a belt drive. The carriage would move, but it was really, really, really stiff. And the spring was good, but everything in there was so dry. There wasn't a drop of oil in this machine. And this has the external crank. It doesn't come off. And it was just a mess. And yet, in 3 hours, I had it running. And I've uploaded a couple videos, and it's actually running quite well. And what I'm going to do now is what I've been wanting to do since I first got into recording, and that is make a recording on the Edison Gem phonograph with a speaking tube and my new Canophonic recorder, just to see what it's going to sound like. It's going to be interesting to do this. The Gem is a remarkably tiny little machine. And I always thought it would be a lot of fun to sit here and make what Edison called round the dinner table recordings, where you have a speaking tube or a recording horn, and you plug it on the machine, everybody just comes up and says, "Hi, it's me, it's Margaret, it's George, it's Bob." You know, it's Christmas 1902 or something. I just thought it would be a lot of fun to be able to do that. And now that I've got this little gem machine and it's up and running, I'm going to do exactly what I've been planning on doing or thinking about doing about the last 6 months or so, and that is I'm going to make a recording of a plain old acoustic recording using a speaking tube, and I am going to be using the new Canophonic recorder. So I'm really curious and really looking forward to making this recording. So I'm going to take the Model C reproducer out, and we're going to install the Canophonic recorder. Now it's made exactly like an Edison recorder, just using modern components, virtually new everything, and we're going to see how well it will work on the Edison Gem. I have been working on the recorders and Edison machines non-stop for almost 4 days now, getting a few hours sleep a night, and then getting up in the morning, jumping in the shower, and heading straight in here and going to work on building recorders or machines. In this case, today, as soon as this arrived, I've done nothing else. I took it out of its box, got it up and running, and it hasn't been idle for more than probably 3 or 4 minutes at a time since then. It's got the standard gem spring. Now there's two gem springs, and most people don't realize that. There's the red spring and the black spring. And I had thought, with all of the stories I've heard about the gem being so underpowered it won't play through a single cylinder, I thought, well, I may have to modify the spring and put a larger spring in it. But it's really surprising. This will play one full cylinder and about a half. And if it'll play one full cylinder and a half, it should record one full cylinder. And the only way to find out, of course, is to record a cylinder and let's see exactly what it does. So, here I have a pristine, brand new, unrecorded black wax cylinder. This was a dictation cylinder, and I just shaved it. Trimmed it, shaved it down to the correct dimensions to fit on the phonograph. And we're going to install the cylinder and just do a quick recording to see what the gem is capable of. And I don't want to record over the entire cylinder just to waste it, but I'll record for a good minute or so and just see what kind of recording we get. This is with the Canophonic recorder using the speaking tube on the Edison Black Gem crank wound machine, completely original except for the belt, which is made out of duct tape. I've got a belt on order and it should be here in the next few days. But so far, this has actually worked surprisingly well. So, in any case, we're going to make a recording on the Edison Gem phonograph and see what it sounds like using the new Canophonic 2-minute recorder. So, the recorder is installed in the carriage. The machine's fully wound. And, well, let's see what happens. This is going to be interesting. Hello, hello, hello! This is Benjamin the Victrola Guy. I am making a test recording on the Edison Gem phonograph. This arrived today. I took it out of its packaging, got it up and running, and I've been playing with it ever since. So this is the 30th day of April, 2012. It is currently 9:40 p.m. I'm making a test recording on a shaved and trimmed Edison Ediphone cylinder. I'm using my speaking tube and I'm speaking in just about a normal voice. I noticed when I first started this recording I was talking too loud and I got an echo. It's still difficult to get used to being able just to speak into a speaking tube rather than having to yell into a speaking tube. So I'm recording this on the Edison Gem phonograph. This arrived today. I got it up and running. I'm using a piece of duct tape for a belt. And I'm using my Canophonic voice recorder and my speaking tube. So this is Benjamin the Victrola Guy making a test recording on the new Gem phonograph. It is April 30th, 2012. It is now 9:41 p.m. Alright, well, it definitely recorded, there's no doubt about that, because you can see for yourself, this cylinder is covered with swarf, just absolutely covered with swarf. Let me grab my swarf brush. And I got a new swarf brush. I got a little fan brush. Really soft. I mean, just like butterfly wing soft. And I can tell by the grooves that this is a fairly loud recording. And it's about a little over a minute, it looks like. But it's going to be really interesting to see what kind of recording we can get on the Edison Gem phonograph. Now, on the first few seconds that I was speaking, I was talking way too loud. And in fact, you can see it in these grooves. The first eighth of an inch of these grooves are... they look twice as deep as the rest of them. So it'll probably echo there. And the reason you get an echo when you're talking too loud using a speaking tube or using a recording horn is you say, hello, hello. And the diaphragm is transmitting that energy to the stylus. And as you say hello, and if it's too loud, the stylus makes a cut. That cut comes around before the stylus is moved over one full groove as the feed screw is moving it, and it bounces in its own indentation. And so you say, hello, 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 hello. And it's just over-modulation. And there's nothing to do about it except speak softer. And there's one little wax here that does not want to come off. Deep grooves. All right, let's remove our recorder. Also covered with swarf. I don't know if you can see this. And I don't have a box to put this in that's handy. Yes, I do. That's good. Because I'm always stressing, if it's not on the machine, it should be in its box. That way, nothing major can happen to it. If you drop one of these recorders, they're gone. End of story. All right, let's reinstall the reproducer. Reinstall the cylinder. I'll give it a couple extra cranks. And we'll just throw on a witch's hat on. There is swarf everywhere in this room. It's on everything. So, the Canophonic recorder recorded on the Edison Gem phonograph. This is it's completely portable. I mean, it weighs nothing and it's extremely small. And it's going to be fun to be able to take this around, show it to people, and then pull out a cylinder, pull out a speaking tube or a small recording horn, and start making recordings on it. And I'm hoping to get a lot of people interested in this, where they're going to say, you know, this is really a neat hobby, and perhaps get some people interested in it and let them get into recording, or let them get into listening to the machines or playing with the machines, buying them, selling them on eBay, whatever. But the Gem is a really neat little machine. It first of all, it's so small. I mean, that's the incredible thing about it. It does everything a bigger machine does. It's really limited in its abilities because it has a fairly small spring, and it's a very primitive motor. It really is. I mean, compared to the motor in the Standard or the Fireside or even in the Amberola, which is also a very simple motor, this one is about as simple as you can get. It has a permanently attached crank, and the crank is on a spring-loaded bar, and the reason for that is if it wasn't spring-loaded, it would turn with the motor. And so this little gem phonograph is it's really cool. It's a really neat little machine. And it has an end gate, so it's supported on both ends. So it it makes it good and solid for taking it around and displaying it and perhaps doing a few recordings in the field. But what I'm going to be using it for is taking it with me and going over to family and friends and just saying, here, talk into this and let's make an Edison cylinder. It's going to be a lot of fun. I'm really looking forward to it. So the Edison gem has arrived. I got it at a really, really decent price, I think. It was being sold for parts, but it was far too nice of a machine to part out. It's in really decent shape. Yeah, it took about 3 hours or so to get it working, but so what? It's not like I was exactly busy today. And when it comes to working on an Edison phonograph, this is not exactly work. I really enjoy working on these old machines. And the fact that this one is so old and in fairly decent condition, and I've got a new belt coming for it. As I said, I'm using a belt made of duct tape, but it works. But it will work better when the new belt gets here. And then I can do some fine tuning on it and perhaps quiet it down. A bit noisy, as all gems are, but not terribly noisy. And it plays well, it records well. It's going to be a lot of fun to play with this machine. And considering I've only had it 8 hours now, the next few days I'll be completely disassembling it, getting all the grit and grime out of the gearing system. And as I said, the motor is really primitive. But I did grease the spring today, which helped dramatically. And you'd be surprised that greasing the spring in a gem increases the available power. It really makes a difference. And I had to replace one screw. This screw was frozen, and tried to back it out, and I caution people about this very thing. The entire half of this screw just broke away, and this old steel gets brittle after years and years and years and years. And so this screw is the end gate screw, and it has a four-lobed leaf spring that keeps tension on the end gate. And so I just used one of the lobes and a little screwdriver and a hammer and just gave it a tap. That broke the screw loose. Pulled it out. Fortunately, I had another screw that was exactly the same thread. Replaced that screw. And other than replacing the belt with a piece of duct tape, I have done nothing to the machine as far as replacing it. It was all adjustments. The bearing, or the mandrel, was way too tight. It wouldn't turn. The feed screw was way too tight. It wouldn't turn. The intermediate gear was way too tight. It wouldn't turn. The governor was too tight. There was no oil in the machine. It looks like it had been sitting for years and years and years. And it had just dried out. And when I first took it out of the box, you couldn't even move the carriage. I had to put some oil on the carriage rod just to get the carriage to move. So just in the last few hours, it's come a long way. It's going to sound better, but I'm extremely happy with this little machine. It's going to be a lot of fun to have it. It's light, it's small, it's portable. It's going to be a lot of fun to take this around and do some recordings out in the field, outside of the Edison room. And I'm really looking forward to doing that. But I just wanted to do a quick video on the gem itself and make a quick recording. A voice recording using the Canophonic 2-minute recorder and my speaking tube. So if you do have any questions or comments on the Edison Gem Phonograph or anything that I've covered in my YouTube series, feel free to drop me an email to victrolaguy@gmail.com. I answer all of my email. I try to answer it the day I get it, but it's getting a bit full now. I have to admit I'm getting dozens of emails a day, so it may take a day or two to get back to you. But if you do have any questions or comments about the Edison Gem or the Edison machines or recording on cylinders or anything I've covered in my YouTube series, feel free to drop me an email. And as I said, I'll get back to you just as soon as I can. So if you would like to drop a quick email or have a question or a comment, feel free. TheVictrolaGuy@gmail.com. And as always, thank you for watching.